Tonight, John and Mark go toy shopping with Mike Patton. Spend quality time with Don Dokken.
80% of all Dokken heads only have three words. How weird is that?
Plus, Atreyu, Frank Bello from Anthrax, Bobby Blitz from Overkill, and Mike Portnoy from Dream Theater. Yeah! This is Talking Metal on Fuse. And now, the number one heavy metal hard rock podcasters, and your hosts, John and Mark. Yeah! Go.
Thank you, Bud Friendly. As always, it is great to be back here on Talking Metal on Fuse.
Definitely a big Talking Metal toast.
Absolutely.
We got Metal Mike ripping it up on the guitar, and we got Mr. Bud Friendly ripping it up on everybody else. How are you, Bud?
I'm just fine, Mark. The doctor said everything will be cleared up in about 3 to 5 days.
And we've got a great cast of people here on the Talking Metal couch. We've got Gary from the band Maelstrom, also from the Talking Metal forums.
We got CC Banana.
Yes!
I'm surprised we could get this guy, actually, but we got him.
He's very expensive, 89 cents a pound.
CC, exciting news, you're going to be performing on a KISS tribute record. Tell us about that.
CC Banana will be appearing on the upcoming KISS tribute record, Kiss My Unk, a tribute to Vinnie Vincent.
Wow. Good luck with that. I'm sure it'll be a smashing success. And my wife, Emily, has joined us again. Yeah. Thanks for coming back.
I love that Dio shirt.
Thank you. This belongs to Mark, though.
Wow.
I can't say. I think I was 9 years old when this tour went out on the road, so I wasn't there. Very good.
I was 30. Anyways, we recently got back from L.A.
Yeah, we had such a great time out there. We hooked up with so many great artists, and one of them, Mike Patton, one of the most innovative vocalists of our time. I mean, Mr. Bungle, Phantomas, Tomahawk, and, of course, Faith No More. My life is falling to
We met up with Mike at a toy store down on Melrose called Monkey King. And a lot of people hang out at the store. Buzz from the Melvins is there shopping a lot. Mike told us about a new line of toys he has coming out.
Basically what we're doing is this company approached us called Uncle. And they suggested, you know, why don't we do a line of Ipecac toys? And I said, well, what does that mean? You know, I don't want to be a character, you know, I don't want to be a toy. And they said, well, why don't we do them for each band on your label? Sound like a good idea? They sent us some mock-ups and they look really cool.
Yeah, the toys look great. You can buy them on their website, ipecac.com.
This has been a great label, though. So many great bands have come out on this label. The Melvins, Mondo Generator, Isis, most of Mike Patton's solo projects since he left Faith No More, and of course, Phantomas.
Mike's projects are all very, very different. He's toured with so many bands and he's played in so many places, but I had to ask him, what was the craziest place he's ever played?
Played a couple of mental hospitals.
Wow.
One was with an improv jazz group. It was like saxophone, drums, bass, guitar, and vocals. All improvised, you know, playing that kind of stuff for mental patients.
Wow.
Yeah. Fireworks.
Mike has had so many amazing bands, and he's done some great collaborations with people like Sepultura, Cool Keith, Bjork.
Yeah, and all us metal fans love the work he did with the Dillinger Escape Plan.
For the most part, the ones I do are ones that I know will come out good. Me and Dillinger were friends. They did several tours with Mr. Bungle. They went through a tough period where they lost a singer and were kind of in transition and, you know, asked me to kind of fill in for a minute.
Speaking of collaborations, Mike is working on a new project with Dan the Automator called Crudo, so be on the lookout for that.
It's amazing. Mike is always doing new stuff. He's done like 18,000 bands. You got Mr. Bungle, Mr. Big, Mr. Mister, Twisted Sister. It's amazing. The man is a machine.
I didn't know he was in Twisted Sister.
Actually, I don't think he's in some of those bands, but yeah.
I think the guy in the costume's ruining the integrity of the show.
Normally, I'm the weird-looking one, people.
Now, the one band that most people think of when they think of Mike Patton is, of course, Faith No More. And, I mean, the influence of this band is just staggering.
I have good memories of that band, you know? That band really taught me everything. Every band is like a learning experience. That's my school.
Yeah.
And every time I start a new one, there's something I'm trying to kind of learn. Yeah. And Victim One was the first one.
You were really young when you started that.
I was 19.
He's never really had quite the popularity in sense of record sales since Faith No More. So it led me to wonder, would he ever consider putting Faith No More back together?
I really highly doubt it. Those guys are all good friends. Yes, there have been Faith No More offers. I'm not an idiot. If the money was insane, I'd consider it. But I don't see any real musical reason to make it happen kind of on its own right now.
Well, we need somebody really rich to come up with some money because it sounds like the offers just haven't been high enough yet. But maybe Donald Trump is a Faith No More fan. Who knows?
I believe Donald Trump lost it all when he sunk all his money into the Trickster reunion.
It was a lot of fun hanging out with Mike.
Be sure to check out the Ipecac Recordings website to find out what Mike's working on next.
Coming up, some intimate conversations with Don Dokken. Record shopping with Atreyu and a talking metal tribute to Motorhead when Talking Metal on Fuse returns. But first, it's the Talking Metal Top 3 with Kerry King from Slayer.
Hey, this is Kerry King. You're playing Slayer. Probably the three coolest things about keeping snakes, you don't have to have somebody come over every day. You know, come over every 7 to 10 days for once to eat, feed it. Number two, I mean, I just enjoy the pattern. Number three, I know so much about breeding that I can produce things that have never existed. And I've done it before and I'll do it again.
Metalheads, it's Talking Metal on Fuse. Take it away, John and Mark.
Thank you, Bud Friendly and Metal Mike.
While we were in LA, we actually got to go into the studio with a metal legend, Don Dokken.
We got to talk to him about his new acoustic solo tour to promote his album, Solitary.
This is the first time you're ever going to go out, just you and a piano and a guitar.
Yeah, it's scary. And Jeff Tate called me, he says, we're going on tour, and maybe it'd be cool if you're a special guest. I go, by myself? He goes, yeah, just acoustic guitar and maybe some guy jamming with you or a guy on piano. And then next thing I know, we're doing 30 shows, and at least I get to see you guys every night for free.
Yeah.
So I can look at it that way. Right. I love Queensryche.
We recently saw the acoustic tour in New Jersey, and it was really a lot of fun. It was like a set of greatest hits. Emily was with me. What did you think of the set, Emily?
I thought it was awesome. I mean, they were opening for Queensryche, and the songs have really held up over the course of time. And the thing that was most amazing was the fact that I thought that Mark was going to blow everyone's eardrums out because he was singing so loud.
I love Don Dokken.
And a cool thing that recently happened is Dokken went to his vaults and discovered this whole concert of classic 1981 Dokken that had never been released, and he didn't even know he had it.
Right, there were some songs in there that he didn't know the titles of.
They had asked us to do a 25th anniversary of Breaking the Chains, the song. Well, I think I have the master, and I'll go pull Breaking the Chains out of the Dokken vaults, and we'll remix it. So I went there, and I just saw these boxes, and I looked at it, and I said, what's this? And it said Dokken Live. Pulled up the tracks. And I just kept going, what is this? Because we're playing just Breaking the Chains and two songs I never even heard of. And I'm going, that's me singing.
Right.
That's George playing it. I know it's George, that's me. And I said, oh, I remember that. God is my witness, there's no overdubs.
Right.
There's no vocal fixes. The souls, it is what it is, how it went down.
That's cool.
And that's the end of it.
It's great.
And it sounds pretty cool.
So that is out from conception. 1981, live Dokken. Be sure to pick that up.
Speaking of the early days of Dokken, we asked him about the early days in the Sunset Strip.
We started at the Rainbow. We played the Whiskey with Van Halen. We were out in 81, 82, Breaking the Chains, and right after that follow-up, Motley Crue would come out with Too Fast for Love. Then I saw these other bands like Poison lived like in the Midwest, and they came out here. So I played with all these bands, we grew up together, and I remember there was just tons of girls, and they looked like they just walked out of the strip bar. And that's just the way it was in the 80s, and it was exciting.
Bands like Dokken, Quiet Riot, Van Halen, they're the ones that started the whole Sunset Strip scene. He told us about hearing Van Halen for the first time.
At that time, I thought I was a pretty good guitar player. I did my show, went back to my dressing room, I heard this thing going on, and I'm like, I thought they only had one guitar player. And I remember walking out of my dressing room on this balcony, looking down at the balcony, and looking at Eddie and going, what the hell is he doing? And he had the two hands on the neck, and I'm like, what the hell is that? I'd never seen it before. I said, the night I saw you play, I said, well, that's it, it's over. I'm putting the guitar down. In my opinion, Eddie was the next guy after Hendrix.
Don witnessed so many historic events back there in the heyday of Hollywood rock.
And Don was actually at the gig where his manager signed and discovered Metallica. Doctors imprisoning me,
all that I see, absolute horror. My manager, Cliff Bernstein, signed Metallica. Wow. And I remember the night he went to the Troubadour and went with them. Now you gotta remember, it's the days of Def Leppard. Big harmonies and reverb and production, and we're watching Metallica, and Cliff goes, I'm gonna sign these guys, you know, they're gonna be big, and I'm going, what are you talking about? I mean, they're kind of rough and ragged, and they're aggressive. I didn't get it. And I thought, it's a waste of time. I mean, this, it's because they weren't in vogue, and the rest is history. I remember thinking, when they go on stage, every show they did was kind of like it's our last show. It was 150% every night. They just were so in your face, and I got that.
Dokken has a theory about why some of his songs have been popular and why some have not.
It's a very interesting theory.
I just took all the Dokken records, and I had to get in this headspace for this record of what did people like about us. I found out this really weird novelty thing. You know, almost 80% of all Dokken hits only had three words. Think about it. It's not love. I'm the hunter alone again.
Into the fire.
And I'm like, oh, I get it. That's why Burn Like a Flame wasn't very popular. Too many syllables.
Speaking of three words, Don let us hear a new song, Heart of Stone.
It's going to be a hit.
From the album Lightning Strikes Again.
This doesn't sound like Doc, and I don't know what it is. It's kind of crossed between It's Not Love and Just Got Lucky.
So Dokken.
Yeah, I love the
It's like
chorus.
1985. The minor seventh.
Yeah, I would just show up at Mike to produce it.
That's typical Dokken.
Oh, it's heavy too. Can't see your face anymore through our broken past. I can't feel your pain anymore. I'm realized. Lightning Strikes Again, which of course is an old Dokken song, so we know that it's going back to that old sound.
In the meantime, all the fans should go out and pick up Solitary, his second solo album, and From Conception.
Still ahead, Atreyu take over the metal detector.
There's not a single friendly thing about this album.
And a killer metal jam with Frank from Anthrax, Bobby from Overkill, and Mike from Dream Theater. It's only here on Talking Metal on Fuse. But first, on this day in history, February 28th, 1996.
On February 28th, 1996, the four original members of KISS made an unannounced appearance in full makeup and Love Gun costumes at the Grammy Awards in Los Angeles, signaling the launch of the historic KISS reunion. Tour dates began selling out in minutes, commencing with an unforgettable concert at Detroit's Tiger Stadium, where KISS played to nearly 40,000 rabid fans. The tour lasted for close to 200 shows and earned over $40 million in nearly a year, making KISS the top-grossing concert act of 1996.
Hi everybody, this is Rob Halford, the Metal God, and this is Talking Metal.
Welcome back to Talking Metal on Views.
And bug friendly. When we were out in Southern California, we hooked up with the guys from Atreyu at a great record store called Green Records, where Alex, the singer, used to work.
Atreyu put out a great record last year called Lead Sails, Paper Anchor. It definitely moved Atreyu's sound more into the metal direction.
This record was the one record for us where we're like, all right, let's just do whatever we want. Let's not conform to what we've been doing in the past.
I let Atreyu take over the Metal Detector and tell us about some albums, old and new.
It's time for the Metal Detector, brought to you by Atreyu.
So Mark, what do you got there?
This is a new band called O Sleeper on Solid State.
What do you got, Alex?
I got Minor Threat, the complete discography. It's pretty violent and intense.
Travis, how about you, man?
I chose Slayer, Rain of Blood, which is an obvious classic. And it's just, there's not a single friendly thing about this album.
Those are some great recommendations. Check those out.
And definitely check out their album, Lead Sails, Paper Anchor, and check out their cover of Faith No More's Epic.
Speaking of covers, we recently covered a great Motorhead song with some real heavy hitters.
Mike Portnoy from Dream Theater. Frankie Bello from Anthrax. And Bobby Blitz from Overkill.
Overkill actually got their name from that particular Motorhead song.
Absolutely. Gary, Overkill?
One of the greatest sounding bands I've ever heard. Love Bobby Blitz.
She does this headbanging and this pelvic thrusting at the same time.
Does Mark know how to do that?
Yeah, now he does.
If Mark could do that, he'd never leave the house.
We got all these guys together and figured we had to come up with a really rock and roll heavy metal name.
Yeah, and Mike had a good one.
You got Motorhead. You got your Radiohead. You got your Oyster Head. You got your Mushroom Head. Now you've got your Turtle Head.
You said it right.
And now, performing the classic Overkill, it's Turtlehead in today's Metal Jam.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We're Turtlehead, and we play rock and roll.
I think Motorhead just hit you. You know, when you first hear them, it's like, yes, I have to hear that. I need more of that.
But when I first heard them, I mean, eyebrow goes up and goes, oh, my life's changed.
First time I heard this song, Overkill, I had never heard a drummer just play double bass the whole way through. That set the level for double bass drumming.
Don't sweat, get back to you.
want to thank you guys, the Talking Metal family, Bud Friendly, Metal Mike, and thanks to all you guys watching at home.
We will see you next time on Fuse.
Ah, 10. Wow.